the topics that are left. While doing Cold War, I intentionally left few things, so now today I will cover them, and I presume you would have read them by far. Then I will talk about the topic of colonization and decolonization. I will explain it in one such way that any and every question whichever you encounter in your exam, you will be very, very comfortable to solve those questions. And besides that, then I will explain you about the Chinese Revolution and the Japanese Meiji Restoration in a little brief way and give you a write-up of it. And that is it. This is all that we have to do. And with it, our course of world history comes to a conclusion. So when I was talking about Cold War yesterday, we have to divide Cold War into some stages as well. So what happened when the Cold War started in 1945 and the manifestation of Cold War started from Berlin, right? It was in Berlin that Cold War started, when the Berlin blockade happened. And then you know what happened, 1949, that Chinese Revolution happened and Mao Zedong came to power in China and the Cold War now intensified. In the meanwhile, in 1955, there was that Korean War, right? And the Cold War further intensified. On the other hand, NATO forces were created and things were going on. Now, it was in 1962 that a great event called Cuban Missile Crisis, it happened. Now, what is this event and why it is important? And today I will link it up with Indian history and international relations so that you can have a more broader perspective of this event. So what happened? Now, this is Europe, this is Western Europe, and this is Eastern Europe. Western Europe and Eastern Europe. Here we have Russia, and then there is an ocean, and then we have USA, right? So what happened is, because there was Cold War, USA and USSR fighting the war, and USSR having its way over Eastern Europe, America had its control over Western Europe. Together they have made NATO and together they have made Warsaw. Now, America played a smart game to keep Eastern Europe under some sort of threat, some sort of tension. America got planted Jupiter missiles in Finland, and these Jupiter missiles were facing the Eastern Europe. So that means that America has created a threat for the Eastern European countries that anytime there can be a missile attack. Now, Eastern Europe is looking towards the big brother Soviets, like, how is it possible that when you are here to protect us, America is threatening us at the front door, right? They have placed their missiles. So Russia decided that in the neighborhood of America we have Cuba, right? So America is vulnerable only through Cuba, and in Cuba Fidel Castro has already established a communist socialist regime. So yes, he is having some kind of link with USSR. America and its CIA tried the best to send the agents of America to crush the communist movement in Cuba, but even they failed in this process. Now, when Cuba has already have its links with Soviets, so Soviets planned that we will plant the nuclear missiles in Cuba facing directly to America and telling the world that how vulnerable America is and how powerful USSR is. And then the missiles were started to be deported to, transported to this island nation, Cuba. But then Americans came to know about it. And America then threatened the Soviets that if the missiles are placed here and if they are not taken back at once, we are ready for Third World War, which will be not just a world war, it will be a nuclear world war, right? When they too were talking about this, entire Europe was trembling, like if this will happen, we will be destroyed, right? Entire Asian nations were trembling that even we will be destroyed if this will be a nuclear war. And the third world countries, the Asian African countries who have formed NAM, now they came forward to make a bridge between the two superpowers. They said, let's sit down, let's talk, guys. It is not that simple that you just decide one fine day that you want to have war. We live as a community of nations. So let's sit and discuss it. Fine. Then some meetings were held, and ultimately America and Soviet Union, the two leaders, the presidents of two countries, they decided, all right, let's solve the problem in a more decent way, in a gentleman's way. Both of us will together do a thing. The Jupiter missile from Finland and the missiles that have been stationed, not planted, in Cuba, they will be removed. So in international relations, we talk about a term. The term is blinking the eye game. Blinking the eye game. And as kids, we all have played that two of us sit together and looking in each other's eyes, the one who will blink the eye first will be lost, like will be losing the game, right? So in this context, in international relation, blinking the eye game means that two big players have come in front of each other. Now who will back out first? The one who will back out first, let's say if America say, all right, first we remove from Finland, that means Soviets are powerful. If Soviet first say, okay, we remove it from Cuba, that means USA is more powerful. So none of them is ready to remove it first. So they had to remove it together. And when they agreed to remove it together, now the possibility is that they can talk to each other because there is a understanding. There is some sort of understanding. With this, when the Cuban missile crisis happened in 1962 and the American and the Soviet presidents met, it was after 1945, this is now 17 long years, that the two leaders agreed to sit together and solve the problems. When they sat, all right, first of all, you know what happens? Whenever there is a problem, there is misunderstanding, there is such a long list of officers who start interacting. Two of us never interact. Because we never interact, there is never a possibility that we can solve the problem, we can nip the evil in the bud. So let's create a hotline link. Hotline link is that there is one phone in White House and one in Kremlin. You press one button and directly it rings here. That means US president from his White House can talk directly to the Soviet president in Kremlin. So they establish a direct hotline link. Let's talk together. Let's solve the problems. This is first step that they did. And now they said, enough of creating so many arms and threatening the global community. Let's do something. Let's do SALT 1. Now what is SALT 1? This is strategic arms limitation treaty, right? Let's sign a treaty and let's start reducing the arms so that the world community is no more under a threat that there can be a big war using more devastating weapons. So let's try create some peace. Now when this all started happening, the political writers say, or the leaders say, this is the time of thaw or détente. Now what is thaw or détente? As we said, this is Cold War. Usually the wars are hotly contested wars. These are hot wars, right? So if there is a hot war, the people are fighting war and you are using weapons against each other, so you try to then cool down the things. Let's cool it down. Let's try to solve the problem. So things must cool down. Here there is a cold war. That means there is some ice between two nations. They do not talk to each other. They do not, you know, interact with each other. There is some kind of distrust, animosity, misunderstandings. Now you go up from here, you heat up the relation. Like you melt the ice and you start talking to each other. So thaw is a science word where hot is turned into cool, or we can say that the cold is turned into hot. So this is thaw time, that you are trying to change the nature of the relationship from cold war. Let's bring some heat. It's the warmth of the relationship, as we say, na, warm relations. So now they are trying to create that warmth in the relationship. That's why they call it thaw. And détente, it is effort for peace. Let's create some peace between two superpowers. Ab ek cheez jo net pe nahi mili hogi for sure, ab wo samajhte hain. This is 1962 globally. This is the time of, we talk globally, it is the time of Cuban missile crisis, USA, USSR, almost at the brink of World War III. If I come to Asia specifically, this is the time when India and China were fighting the border war of 1962. Right? This is the time when India-China were fighting the border war. And Ladakh region and other, right? Northeastern Ladakh. So China was winning the war that time. China has entered inside Indian territory and we were on the back foot, or we were militarily very weak. We were not prepared for this war because it was hardly 15 years of India being independent. We have not yet worked very much on modernizing our armed forces. Moreover, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had a little bit of idealistic kind of a foreign affair policy. He thought that the neighbors will become friends, friends will become brothers, Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai, and we will not fight. We will try to always keep our relations very, very cordial with our neighbors. So that was very idealistic kind of a foreign policy of Pandit Nehru initially. But then when China came, even Nehru was taken up by surprise, and he then started changing his foreign policy towards realism and pragmatism. Now that China was winning the war, all of a sudden China declared unilateral withdrawal. Right, they were winning the war for 1 month together. India was being pushed back, and China could have come more ahead. They could have taken more Indian territory. It was possible that, but then all of a sudden they left the war in 1962 after 1 month. Why? The reason is because this global crisis situation was there, right? And when China was a communist country, so China being a communist country was very close to USSR. And you remember, it was in 1949 with the help of Soviets that the Chinese have made itself a communist China. So China and Soviets were very good friends at that time. And Soviets were seen as bigger power than China, so they were treated as big brothers. Now, India was left alone. Soviets were not helping India at that time for obvious reason. They were helping China, not directly helping China, but they were having some kind of tilt towards China in this war. So USA started laughing at India. See, look at your NAM now. Your neighbor attacked you and nobody is helping you. So if you want, shall we help you in this war? Shall we bail you out? And Pandit Nehru had no other option to say, yes, if you can, please help us. So America declared then that if China will not back out, then there is a possibility that America may enter the war. And America was trying to find an excuse because of this Cuban Missile Crisis to create a bigger trouble for the communists. So they said, if we enter the war, we will decimate China. Soviets will come, world war will happen. That is what we want. Soviet leadership never wanted a war at this point of time because they realized that everyone will be then at a threat. So Soviets immediately sent a message to the Chinese, back out, leave India alone immediately. We don't want America to enter the war at this point of time. China never wanted to do this. They wanted to take over entire Indian territory in the northeast, right? Up to Arunachal, Sikkim and Leh, much part of Leh Ladakh and much part of northeast. So China was reluctant, but then the Soviets put lot of pressure on them and threatened them that we will never ever support you in any future endeavor or whatever. So you have to come back. So China announced unilateral withdrawal and they went back, and the war ended all of a sudden. Even India was surprised how it happened. Now that this happened, China became little annoyed with Soviet Union. When China became annoyed with Soviet Union, this is the time when the communist lobby is becoming weak. Even Russia understands, Soviets understand this, that the lobby is breaking up. And therefore, even they wanted now that there should be some kind of peace, some kind of warmth in the relations. That explains why even they immediately agreed, let's solve all the problems. But America again played very smart. When they realized that China is getting a little, you know, sidelined, and China is getting isolated from Soviet, and China want to come out of the shadow of Soviets, they don't want Soviets to be now their big brothers, American agencies from Pentagon is the military headquarters of America. American agencies from Pentagon contacted the Pindi agency. This is Rawalpindi, Pakistani military headquarters, right? So Pentagon contacted Pindi and offered them a lot of financial aid and strategic help, and asked them to contact Beijing, Chinese agencies. And a meeting of Chinese and the Americans were organized, not one, but a couple of meetings were organized in Rawalpindi, in the Pakistani military headquarters, where America convinced China that we can become friends. And because China at that time needed a lot of money and support, and they had a, you know, grudge against Soviets because of the withdrawal, forced withdrawal, America could easily convince China to become friends with them. Now that Beijing agreed, then started ping pong diplomacy. What is ping pong diplomacy? One American directly flying to China, and in return one Chinese delegate flying to America, and the process continued for many months together. 1 month, let's say defense minister of China is going to America, then American defense minister is going to China, foreign minister going to China, foreign minister going to America. So this continued for months together, and all of a sudden they became very good friends. After they became very good friends, one day in a meeting where all the military heads were sitting, US, China and Pakistan, the Chinese defense personnel, he asked the Pakistani defense personnel, "Yeah, aren't you fools? When in 1962 we attacked India from this side, couldn't you start your war from this side? You could have taken Kashmir, you could have taken Rajasthan, Gujarat region, whatever you could have. So you should have that time attacked India." And Pakistan said, "Ya khuda pehle nahi bola hai na, idea de rahe the bhai jaan, to kar hi dete inshallah hum bhi." So they said, "Even if it this is not a very late, so let's try. Pakistan, you create war in Kashmir. When you create war in Kashmir, we will build up our forces on the borders of Kashmir once again, and India will be in a troubled position. If India sends army into Kashmir, we can make it a pretext that why India is sending so much of army in Kashmir, we will also attack. India will be attacked from both sides and we can easily defeat." USA said, "In this plan, I am ready to invest. You need money, you need arms, you need anything, tell me. I will not send my soldiers, but money and weapons as much as you want. Destroy India, because they are still following the policy of NAM despite we helping them and not joining our lobby." At this point of time, Lal Bahadur Shastri ji was the Prime Minister of India. As planned, Pakistan announced war from Kashmir side, Akhnoor sector. And when the Pakistani soldiers were building up in Kashmir, they entered Kashmir. Our Prime Minister told the defense personnel that don't go to Kashmir, let's open Punjab, Rajasthan and Gujarat borders. We opened these borders, Indian armies reached Lahore, the Chinese had to stay back because there was no build up, Pakistani army had to fall back to save their part that Indian army has already overrun. So India won the war. After winning this war, and a lot of credible inputs for all this were given by Soviets, for obvious reason, because now China and America are friends. That is why after this war, we started becoming closer friends with USSR. Clear everyone? Now this is not explained in books or on Google anywhere, but this is a very important link for modern Indian history. So Cold War wala topic maine pura kar diya. Ab baat aati hai colonization and decolonization ki. So here I am going to talk about a very important part of history. Yes, I am going to talk about first colonialism and imperialism. So there are two words, colonialism and imperialism. This is from colony and this is from imperial. Now what is imperial? The ruler or king or state. Now that means, if it is by some private person or company, right? If it is by some private person or company, it is colonialism. East India Company of England was a private merchant body. They came to India, they colonized it. But when the King of England or Parliament of England, anyone, when they got involved in Indian affairs, it became imperialism. So when state involves itself, the king, the parliament, anyone who is state, if they involve, then it becomes imperialism, because there is imperial authority involved. Otherwise, it is colonialism. Then they may ask you that what were the factors for colonialism. Before we understand the factors for colonialism, imperialism, let's try understand basically what type of colonies are there. So there are things called settlement colonies. Now what are settlement colonies? In Europe, you know that there are very small countries, but then there is growth of population, with the growth of population, you find that you have less resource, you have less resources, you have less territory. Now, how to settle this much of people? So let's find some other place where we can make our people live, work and earn money. So they become settlement colonies. For example, USA was planned as a settlement colony. So people of Europe will go and settle in America, settle in Canada. The entire the American continent was seen as settlement colony. That was all empty land. You know, USA is so big as compared to India territorially, but USA till date has only 33 crore population, whereas India has 140 crore population, USA has 33-35 crore population. Canada, bigger than India, till date they have less than 4 crore population. So it was all empty. It is even till date it is empty. So you will go and settle there and you will make money and live happily, and perhaps you will continue having relations with your countries and you will keep sending your money, right? So this is settlement colony. Then there is economic colonies, the colonies from where you will buy either goods, the finished goods or the raw material, somewhere from which you can buy things and make your economy grow further. India is an example of this colony, right? India was never a settlement colony. The people from Britain will never come to India to settle for their life. They will come, they will exploit, they will go back, take the money with them. That is settlement colonies. Third is penal colonies. Now, what are penal colonies? In Europe, there are few people who are threat for the society, rapists, murderers, thieves, right? People whom, like, you cannot keep anywhere nearby. Send them far away from Europe and they should never come back, and they should live somewhere far away from Europe and die there unknown, unheard. Australia. Put them in a ship, make them sail all far away in the ocean on a very far off continent and leave them there. How will they come back ever? They will die there. But it started as a punishment place, as a prison for the Europeans. But then they realized even here we have so much of the goods and things. So it turned into economic colony. And then they realized it can also be settled. This is a good place. So people were sent there and they also settled. Even in Australia, it is mostly the whites who have gone from Europe. Otherwise, the natives, they are not white. Australian natives are not white. Even they are tribals, right? So this is all, these are three different type of colonies and there can be intermixing of them. So colonialism ke factors kya hain? Dekho, sabse pehla factor tha ki there emerged the idea of nation state in Europe. Nation state in Europe, right? So there was a time when the entire Europe, I told you, know, was called Christendom, the kingdom of the Christ. So it was one Europe. The superficial areas were not considered as political barriers to anyone. But then after that 1648 Peace of Westphalia, I hope you all remember, we discussed it in the initial classes. Now there are different countries in Europe, right, with their boundaries. So in these countries, when the boundaries were created, obviously the war started, when everyone wanted to have bigger states. So the states on the corners of Europe, that is the Spanish and the Portuguese, they thought that they are so small players that if they get involved in the continental wars, they will be lost. So instead of getting involved in the continental war, they started exploring new territories. Let's go outside, find some additional space from where we can get some additional resources. And that is why it was Christopher Columbus of Spain and Vasco da Gama of Portugal who reached America and India. They were the first to explore the territories. So yes, the reason is that with the emergence of nation states in Europe, there was the conflicts in, there were the conflicts in Europe, and the smaller countries on the fringe of Europe who were not very happy involving themselves in the continental wars, like the Spanish and the Portuguese, they moved out. When they moved out, they started settling in different parts in US, in the Caribbean, Latin America, in Africa, in the horns of Africa, on the corners of Africa, and in Asia. They came to India as well. So in this way, the process of colonialism started. So there were geographical discoveries, explorations, they found new routes, they found new territories. And then there was the idea of mercantilism. You remember while we were doing American Revolution, I said that there was British mercantilism and American capitalism. Now what was mercantilism? Go trade with different countries, bring the best things to your country and make profit come to you. So that was spirit of mercantilism. So European traders, they believed that they have to go in every corner of the world to find out the best possible products that they can get from those countries and trade and make huge profits. That is the spirit of mercantilism. Even it was a very important reason for the growth of colonialism. Then the third factor was rapid population growth in Europe, and there were limited resources, limited land in Europe. So you have to find the settlement colonies. As I said, you need to settle your population abroad. So they then explored new territories. Add on to this, the spirit to spread Christianity. There were missionaries who wanted to go to different lands where the message of Christ is not yet very loud. So they said, find, explore, reach, and bring those people, those territories under your control where we can spread the idea of Christ or we can spread Christianity. Then every country wanted to increase its prestige. And how will they increase the prestige? By increasing their territorial conquests. See, I have a territory in Europe, I have a territory in Asia, I have a territory in Africa, in Americas, and in Australia. Sun never set on my dominions. What a prestige it is for Britain. So it was for the prestige of the nation. And last, when the Industrial Revolution started, obviously everyone needed more and more raw material, and everyone needed more and more markets where they can sell their industrial goods. So these are the reasons for explorations and finding new territories where they can establish their colonial possessions. Now we have a very unique case of Africa. What happened in Africa is, see, Africa is called dark continent, not because people living in Africa are dark, and not that there is less knowledge. It is called dark because you could not explore the interior of Africa. Now, why couldn't you explore the interior of Africa? Listen to this very carefully. There are 3-4 reasons. When you understand it logically only, then you can write proper answers. The first thing is, when you come to Asia, countries like India, let's take an example. In India, you know, we had kings like Ashoka, we had kings like Tughlaqs and Lodis and Mughals and who not. And you know that even before the coming of the British, there was lot of infrastructural developments in India. There were roads. GT road was made by Sher Shah Sur, connecting Peshawar to Calcutta. From the borders of Pakistan and Afghanistan to the borders of India and Bangladesh, there had already been road network during the times of Sher Shah, right? So when the Europeans came to these countries, they could easily travel. But Africa is one such densely forested area where there was no infrastructure. Going inside Africa was very, very difficult. So till that time, you will invent steamer. Steamer is a ship run with mechanical energy, and you can navigate the rivers in Africa, which are little dangerous rivers, right? Nile, Zanzibar, any river. So it is very difficult to explore Africa. When you cannot explore Africa, you will not understand that where you can develop your colonial possessions. So Africa was not explored till the time the steamer was invented. And you know, steamer itself was invented in Europe only in 1840s. So that means it will be possible to go deep inside Africa after 1840s. Before this, any and every European country is staying close to the horns of Africa, on the outskirts of Africa. Second, now when you try to go inside the forest, try to find the ways, in Africa there was a new challenge. The challenge was malaria, yellow fever, and till the time you find a permanent cure to these, like if there is malaria, you need to have quinine as a medicine. If you will not have, you will not be healthy again, and you may die even. And at one point of time, even malaria was considered an epidemic, right? So when people started going inside Africa, for the Europeans particularly, there were so many new diseases for them. They could not survive the mosquito bite even. People used to die there only. So it was called the graveyard of the white race. Africa was called graveyard of the white race. So there is problem of navigation or traveling inside Africa to understand the African region. There is problem of diseases for which the Europeans are not yet prepared. And when after 1817, the Europeans will find the medicine for malaria, yellow fever and other things, only then they can have that privilege that, okay, let's take the risk, go inside Africa, explore the new places, and if there is a mosquito bite, you can have this medicine and you can survive. So then people start traveling more and more. Now Do you remember when we talk about the revolt of 1857, we always talk that there was greased cartridges because of which there was revolt, right? You know that story, na? That there was greased cartridges and because of which the revolt of 1857 happened. So what was that greased cartridge? There was a paper sealed with the gunpowder sealed inside the paper, and you have to bite the paper to take the gunpowder into the barrel of the gun and then fire. That means it is called open gunpowder, right? It is not sealed, it is open gunpowder. And then the story was, when you put that gunpowder in this paper and you seal it, you use some kind of fat of pig or cow. So pig is considered inauspicious by Muslim, and cow is so very sacred for Hindus that we cannot touch the meat of any of these two. If I am a Hindu, I cannot touch meat of cow, and if I am a Muslim, I cannot touch the meat of pig, for me it is sin, right? Dozak mein jana padega na, wo to aisa ho gaya. So now, because of it, in India we had a revolt. But now try understand, you keep open gunpowder, you put it in a piece of paper, you bite, you pull it out, you put it in barrel, and then you fire. These days, when it is rainy season, like, people talk about so many things, but our mothers in India, what they say, if you are opening the packet of biscuit, please put it in an airtight jar. Ye to seale ho jayenge na, khaye nahi jayenge. So if it is moist climate, the open thing will not be functioning properly. So that open gunpowder, when taken to Africa, and Africa being a damp and moist climate region, so it became dysfunctional. You cannot use your gunpowder in Africa, and then you have to fight against the people of Africa, the tribals of Africa, people like Chris Gayle. Now your guns are not working and Gayle is running towards you. So think about you now. How will you feel? Your guns are not working and Gayle with his bat is running towards you. So you will say, "No, sorry sir, we'll never come back." Right? So when the percussion cap was invented, now what is percussion cap? The gun, the bullet that we see today, na, framed in a steel, like you put the gunpowder and you seal it permanently and then use it. There is no need to open and put out the gunpowder into something and then fire. Now you have proper bullets. Now these were invented in 1865. After that, now it is possible that you can take your gunpowder effectively in Africa and fight the wars. So Africa was started to be colonized after 1870. Before this, it was not possible. Now that Africa has been properly investigated, you have traveled, when you have streamers, now there is a craze to enter Africa and get more and more territories from where you can get more and more raw material and make more and more markets for your finished goods. Now this is called, yes, diamond mines. Obviously, raw material means everything. Diamond mines will give you raw diamonds, then you will bring them, polish them, and then they become the fine quality diamonds, right? Even gold for that case. Now that you got to know much about Africa, so what the European writers say, the mad race for Africa or the scramble for Africa started, mad rush started. Every European country wanted to enter into Africa. Looking at this, that everyone wanted to enter into Africa, there was a possibility that the Europeans may end up fighting against each other. That is why what happened, that Bismarck called Berlin Conference, which I talked about the other day. Bismarck called a Berlin Conference where he asked all the European leaders to come sit and decide the fate of Africa. And then the paper division of Africa happened. On a map, on a given map of Africa, the Europeans drew the lines, and once they drew the lines, the entire Africa was divided among the Europeans. Is it clear now? Colonization of Africa, causes and how Africa was colonized. Great. Now if anyone asks you what was the impact of colonization on Africa, so that's pretty obvious. What was the impact of colonization on India? We lost our independence, right? We lost our independence. Political impact, the foreigners ruled over us and they exploited us. Economically, there was drain of wealth, our resources were used for their benefit. And because of this exploitation and discrimination in Africa, though discrimination was much more than what it was in India. If in India they treated us like Indians and dogs, not allowed. In Africa, there was a trend that they used to, even chain the Africans as if the Africans are their pets. Fine. And there was a concept of social Darwinism. Darwin always says that it is the survival of the fittest. So there are races, the races evolve, and when the races evolve, the survival of the fittest happens, like the best survives, and the others are like they just perish. Social Darwinism. I give you a very simple example to relate and understand. In many European countries and even in USA, in the 1800s, in the second half of 1800s and early 1900s, there were human zoos. Human zoo. What is human zoo? They brought African people, right? So there is one cage in which you have simple monkey, the second cage in which you have a chimpanzee, the third cage in which you see a ape standing, and the fourth in which an African standing. They said this is how the human race evolved. And the people used to buy tickets to see this, and the African people were standing naked inside them. This is how Africa was treated by the Europeans. They showed their kids that this is how the human race evolves. Look at this. That is social Darwinism. Now, when they ask you the process of decolonization of Africa, or for that matter, decolonization in East Asia, decolonization in South America, or anywhere, let's try understand a very basic concept today. You will never end up writing a wrong answer in history, right? Let's take few examples and listen to all of these examples very, 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 very carefully, right? See, forget about Africa, Latin America, or East Asia. Let's talk about India first. The Europeans came to India, the British came to India, and for their purpose, so that they can get some cheap clerks in India, they started teaching us English. When they taught us some basic English, we started understanding the concepts like liberty, equality, justice, rights, and democracy, right? And then we started demanding the same things from them. Will it not be replicated everywhere? Wherever the Europeans will go, they will always try to do the same. Now, let's teach the natives, some of the natives, the basic English language so that we can use them for our specific small jobs. For that purpose, you teach them English, and once you teach the natives English, the natives will then become familiar with the English vocabulary and the terminology. That is the Enlightenment ideas. Moreover, when you teach them English, they will read events like American War of Independence and the Russian Revolution or the French Revolution or the European Revolutions, and they will understand that what exactly they have to do. So, introduction of English language in all these countries, these continents, will become one of the reasons for them to have the spirit of nationalism and fight for their independence. This will be the reason for decolonization. Now, second point, when the Europeans come, before that, all these countries, if I take specific example of India and then compare it with Africa, in India, there were so many different kings ruling in small territories, right? When they were ruling in small territories, so let's say there were three people living in three different territories under three different kings. One king was very good. Now, does it make any difference to the other two? You live under one king, they too live under another king, right? Different kings. So your king is very good. Will it benefit them? Will they have any advantage of your king being good because they are citizens of some other, they are subject to some other king? So your king gives you so much benefits, they cannot get any benefit from your king, and their king is very bad. Will you have any reason to think about them? Their king is bad. You said, okay, that's their luck. I have to got the best king. That's okay. Why should I bother about them now? When British came, three of you came under British control. Three of you are treated alike. Three of you are now one. You have a common enemy. You are ready to join hands to fight him. This is rise of nationalism. Similarly, in Africa, there were several tribes living in different areas fighting with each other, right? But now the Europeans came, started ruling them and exploiting them. Even they realized that we have to join hands and fight against them. So rise of nationalism. So one, you come in contact with modern ideas of West. Two, the problem is, one is that there is exploitation. Two, there is English education. One is that there is English education, and you come familiar with different ideas, Western ideas, modern ideas. Number two, second is that you have now common rulers who are exploiting you, and that is why you want to join hands and fight against them. Third is the economic exploitation of your resources by the foreigners. You feel bad about it, that why the hell they exploit our resources and they become rich and we become poor. So same happened in Africa, same happened in Latin America, same happened in the Eastern Asian countries, Southeast Asian countries. Now, one of the very important reasons for the process of decolonization to pick up pace in India, if I talk about the main freedom fighters, the national leaders, heroes, Dadabhai Naroji, Subhash Chandra Bose, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, and Mahatma Gandhi, Gopal Krishan Gokhale, and you name many of them. Who are they? They are English educated people who went to European countries to study. Mahatma Gandhi went to England, Jawaharlal Nehru went to England, Dr. Ambedkar went to England and to America. So they went to these European countries. When they went there to study, what they realized is, see how good the life of the people in these countries is. Why? Because they are independent. Why we are treated so bad? Why we are treated like second grade citizens? Because we are slaves of these countries. So till the time we fight for our independence, till the time we find that how we have to live life with dignity, by our efforts, how can we survive as human beings? So they came back and became the heroes of national freedom struggles. So same was the history in Africa. Many of the African middle class educated people who went to European countries to study, they came back to their countries to fight against the oppression of the Europeans. So they became the natural heroes of Africa, or for that case of Southeast Asia and everywhere. Another thing now, World War I and World War II rendered Europe weak, and this weak Europe did not have the resolve or the courage and the capability to hold on to the colonial empire. And with the world wars, the Europeans were getting weak, and the nationalism in Afro-Asian countries, it was becoming strong. So after World War II, it was all the more difficult for Europe now to hold on to its colonial possession with the same strength with which they had earlier been able to do. So therefore, after World War II, the colonial empire started to dismantle and the process of decolonization picked up pace. So from my side, I have explained colonialism, decolonialism, I have explained European unification, I have completed the Cold War. Now I have to just give you an idea about Japanese Meiji Restoration, a little history of it, because I have already done it while doing that Industrial Revolution, and last that I have to do is Chinese Revolution, and that is it. Then the world history gets end today. So now I am going to talk about China. In China, as we say, in India, Mughals were the last rulers to rule, right? In China, it were the Manchu rulers, right? When the Manchus were ruling in China, Manchus started becoming weak. When the Manchus were becoming weak, the Europeans wanted to capitalize and enter into China as well. China being a huge market and China being a place from where they get tea, they get textile, they get ginseng and so much of the spices and other things. So they all started talking to China that you have to open up, right? Now, when they were forcing China to open up for trade, China was reluctant to some extent. China was not very happy. Meanwhile, Britain, who had already occupied India, British from India were trading with China. From China, they were buying tea, they were buying textile and so much, so on, so forth. Fine. But then British have to pay Chinese for all these things, the products that they buy from them. And that was taking a lot of money from the British control. So British in India started growing opium and giving opium to the Chinese in lieu of the things that China could give them. But the Chinese authorities said, see, we don't need opium. As much as of the opium which is required for our medicine purpose, we can grow it domestically. Then why are you sending so much opium? Why are you trying to opiate the Chinese? But the British forced opium on China, and British fought two opium wars against China, right? After fighting these two opium wars and defeating China in the opium wars, now Britain forced China to open its ports for British trade. And in the meanwhile, the Germans came. In the meanwhile, the French came. The Americans started trying to enter here. So all Europeans and Western nations tried to enter China, with which there was a cultural shock in China that how is it possible that so many Europeans have all of a sudden entered our markets and exploiting us. As it was in India, we had 1857 revolt and things like that. Even in China, people started revolting. And Manchus became very unpopular because they couldn't handle the situation. Obviously, they were weak. So in China, a nationalist party was made, and the leader of the nationalist party was Sun Yat-sen. And this man, Sun Yat-sen, he said, let's bring first the Manchus to an end. Let's end monarchy in China. Let's make China a republic. So Sun Yat-sen and his nationalist party started talking about making China a republic, and by 1912 they successfully made China a republic. Now China has become republic, Manchus are gone. But when the Manchus were weak, as in India, when the Mughals were weak, there were many Nawabs and many provincial governors who declared themselves independent. So was the case in China. When the Manchus were weak, there were warlords. These warlords are like the Nawabs in India, who have declared themselves very powerful in every nook and corner of China. So the nationalists now had to fight against the warlords as well. This war continued for some time, and in the meanwhile, Sun Yat-sen died, and the Nationalist Party got its new leader in the name of Chiang Kai-shek. Right? Now he is the new leader of Nationalist Party, and he continued fighting against the warlords and finally exterminated them. Now China is republic, China is little stable. In the meanwhile, in 1917, Russian Revolution happened, and this Russian Revolution then made Russia USSR. In USSR, the communist ideology became popular, and it traveled to India and China, and the Chinese Communist Party was made by Mao. Now in China, the Nationalist Party of Chiang is confronted by the Chinese Communist Party Mao, and there is fight between the two. The two started fighting. While they were fighting, meanwhile, Japan, which has become an industrialized country, it started exploring more territories, and they attacked China. When they attacked China, Mao offered support to Chiang, so that let us two become one to save China. As I told yesterday, Chiang played a little smart. He asked the Maoists to fight against the Japanese, and himself started killing the Maoists. So the Maoist has to escape on the long march, right? When they went on a long march, they kept hiding for the time, till the time the World War II was not over and Japan did not surrender. When the Japanese surrendered, the Japanese soldiers in China, they had to be now taken out, for which the Soviet army was sent, and Soviet army supported Mao, and Mao became the leader of China. China became Communist China, and they declared it People's Republic of China. People's Republic of China under Mao Zedong, 1949, and this man Chiang, he escaped to Taiwan with the help of America. And throughout the Cold War, America kept supporting up to that middle of the Cold War, now where China then became friends with that. So America kept supporting Taiwan. When America was supporting Taiwan, you know, originally Taiwan was the permanent member of Security Council, not China. China was not the permanent member of Security Council, it was Taiwan. And after 1962, America proposed that China should be the permanent member. And that time America and China became better friends, right? So this is how Chinese Revolution happened. You know what happened when Chinese Revolution happened? Now there are two important stories. There are two important stories to remember here. One, when Mao became the leader and the Chinese wrote their new constitution, in which they said that there will be democracy, but there will be only one party. So there will be regular elections, and you people will come and vote, and you have many choices. You can choose communist. Now there is no other party, but you can vote, and this is the democracy of China, right? Now I hope you understand, there is no democracy. So China wrote a constitution which was never a truly democratic constitution, but they said yes, we are fine. Now that China wrote a constitution, at that time 1950s, Mao said, the leader said, there is a 100 flower campaign. I would appreciate the 100 best objections to this constitution, right? So Mao said, I would appreciate 100 best objections to this constitution, where we fail, where we lack. Those who will tell us, they will be rewarded. So many people in China with political orientation, they wrote extensively, this is bad, this is bad, this is bad. The best 100, they were killed. Uske baad dobara pucha, they ask again, like, how is the constitution? Everyone said, best sir. Isse achha constitution kaise likha ja sakta hai? Aur uske baad dobara unhone pucha hi nahi kabhi, best hai yaar, jo chal raha hai, jaise chal raha hai, achha to chal raha hai. Enjoy karo life ko, puchna nahi hota, chai peeni hoti hai, subah utke green tea bas. Done. So this is how China reacted when people objected. Then when in Eastern Europe in 1985 to 89's time, in Eastern Europe there were revolutions, Velvet Revolution in Czechoslovakia, Prague uprising, this uprising, that uprising. So when all Eastern European countries were fighting against the communist regimes and wanted to truly become democratic, even in China the student union tried it. Thousands of students, they came on the streets fighting for democracy to be restored, to be established, to be introduced in China. And it was Tiananmen Square. And the Chinese army came and killed thousands of students. After that, nobody again asked for democracy in China. They said, okay, yeah, it's all right. Let's not try it again. It's quite heavy a price to pay for democracy. Abhi bhi China is like keeping the democratic elements in Hong Kong under check. That's why they are keeping so much of the armed guards in Hong Kong. So China is not at all democratic. Chalo. Now I will tell you something about Japan. In Japan, there was a tradition that there was a ruling family, the kings of Japan. But for the last more than 200 and plus years, the kings had been sidelined. They had been confined to their palace, not allowed to take any decision politically or whatsoever. And across Japan, there were many territories divided by Tokugawa shoguns. They are like the warlords in China, Tokugawa shoguns. So they were keeping all control over Japan, right? They were very conservative, had no contact outside Japan, and lived a life of complete isolation. Right, conservative, isolated life of the Japanese people. Now, when USA started becoming a little strong by 1850s, after it's like good now, 70 years of independence, they are becoming importantly thoda little stronger. So they started exploring territories for them. And a American commander, Matthew Perry, reached the Japanese coast. And he asked Japan to adopt, what was the name of the policy? Open door policy. Can you please open up for trade with us? And the Japanese never wanted to open up for trade. They feared that the way the Europeans have exploited the Asians, the Indians, the Chinese, they will start exploiting Japan. So they said, no, we do not want to open up. When they said we do not want to open up, the Americans bombed the cities on the coast of Japan. And the names of the cities are not important, Shimonoseki and other cities, and then that's not important. So Tokugawa shoguns, they wanted to keep control over Japan, keep it isolated. Americans wanted to enter, they didn't. But when they attacked Japan, now Tokugawa shoguns became very unpopular. That see, who are they to take decisions? Why shouldn't kings take the decisions? So people of Japan, they then came out against Tokugawa shoguns and they said, let's go for Meiji Restoration. Restoration. Now, what is Meiji Restoration? To bring back the kings. Who is Meiji? Meiji is someone who is very strong, very enlightened. So, Tenno Mitsuhito was now restored as the king. Tenno Mitsuhito became the king. And this man then said, let Japan go for industrial revolution. And then Japan became a industrialized country, first industrialized country in Asia. And within 30 years, it reached the levels of Americans and the Europeans. It was in 1868. That means by 1898 or 1900, Japan was one of the leading industrial powers in the world. Now this Japan that have all of a sudden become such a powerful industrial empire, they need a lot of territory, right? Because they want a lot of territory, they started fighting war against Russia, Russo-Japanese War. I hope you remember 1904-5, after which there was revolution in Russia as well. Japan defeated Russia, brought much of the territory under its control. Then Japan started moving towards China. And you know, during World War II, the Japanese king said, I have a dream. The dream is Ark of Solidarity under Divine Hirohito. Now, what is this Ark of Solidarity? He said, from Japan to Korea to China, Manchuria, India, Australia, New Zealand, this will be Japanese territory. Ye sari territory Japan ki ho jayegi. America kehta hai, tumne itna dekh kaise liye itni dur tak? तुम्हें नहीं छोड़ेंगे इसलिए तुम्हारे ऊपर एटम बॉम्ब गिराए जाएंगे। लाइक इतना बड़ा ड्रीम, एक छोटा सा कॉन्टिनेंट छोटी सी आइलैंड नेशन थिंकिंग अबाउट कंट्रोलिंग दिस ह्यूज एन एम्पायर, अमेरिका सेड नो नो नो, दिस इज़ वेरी डेंजरस इन फ्यूचर, सो डिस्ट्रॉय देम एंड ब्रिंग देम अंडर योर कंट्रोल. दिस इज हिस्ट्री ऑफ जापान.